we have one more presentation by a distinguished economist who is a number three, my sense of the university. Sir, may I request you to say in possibly as briefly as possible, maybe in 10 minutes, our budget and rural areas.
So, at the outset, I have to congratulate them for having a good discussion on a topic of current interest among all of us, because the budget is just presented only on 6th of this month in the parliament. Lot of debate, discussion is still going on, and it has to go on because it affects all the people in the country. The morning somebody was doubting, Professor Rahmatullah himself was doubting whether I am the right man to host this session on the budget. You are the right person, because nothing is beyond public administration. Everything comes under administration, whether it is science, arts, social science, budget, this, that. Everything is a part of administration. Therefore, you are a professor of public administration, and you have got a right to organize seminars, and this is the right way of organizing, because it is related to public policy, and all policies, policy related matters, and especially budget. Budget is a part of financial administration, which we'll be teaching as a part of public finance, rightly told in the morning by Professor Haragopal. So therefore, and after all, what is budget? Budget is nothing but it shows the income, or it presents the income and expenditure of the government. So when it is reflects the income and expenditure of a government, it is nothing but related to public policy. It's a part of public administration itself. That's why you have got a right, and a right person is chairing the session, right person spoke in the morning, and we are also the right person because we are connected very much these budgets. So here, in the morning, some very important issues were thrown for discussion by Professor Haragopal. And I have to also thank Professor Rahmatullah for getting again Haragopal here, because he has gone to the roots of the budget. And that's the real thing. Because who prepares a budget, how it is prepared, for what purpose it is prepared, and what is the philosophy behind this, all these things we have to understand. So my topic is budget and its impact on rural development. That is a specific topic, but I should tell you that some background of budget is also required to understand what exactly is the relationship between even the recent budget and rural development in the case of our country. So you have heard historical perspective of the budget preparation and the planning process in this country and the growth process in the country in the morning session, and also just now you heard by Professor Vijay Madam about the concept of inclusive growth. So as a part of concept of inclusive growth itself, we have to speak about the relationship between rural development and the budget. Because as all of you know, for the past, you know, right from beginning, right from 1947, even when Mahatma Gandhi was alive, the real development of this country is rural development. That was Gandhi was speaking about. Because you know that in 1950s and even now, when my own teachers were teaching me economics in the classrooms, they used to say that 80% of the people in this country are living in rural areas. Even now also, 80% of the people are still, I think hardly 3-4% change might have been there, but still, overall situation has not changed much. But if you look at Western countries, especially if you take the example of America, hardly 5-6% of the people depend on agriculture. 90-95% of the people, they depend on non-agricultural activities. That is, urban-based activities they'll be carrying out, and they get a very fairly good living. That how these 5-6% fellows, they feed the 95% of the population in the country. So it is because of mechanization and also modernization of agriculture and all, and there is a total change in the rural scenario in the case of those countries. So what all development models also say in economics is that when development takes place, the rural, there will be expansion of non-agricultural and non-rural based activities, and that is how the face of the economy goes on changing over a period of time. But this has not happened in the case of Indian context. It is because the non-agricultural sector has not expanded to the extent that we intended for the past 60 years. And therefore, still most of the illiteracy, as Professor Vijay Madam was pointing out, that 40% of the masses in this country are still illiterates. And most of them are only, or almost all of them, we can say, are only rural masses. And then 30% of the population is still below the poverty line. In the morning, the Planning Commission member, Farooq Kamar, he was talking about, he himself is not believing the statistics of the Planning Commission that only 26% of the population is below the poverty line. So we can say roughly 30% of the people, that is one third of the people, are still below the poverty line in this country. So why, even after more than 60 years of independence, one third of the population in the country is below the poverty line? Why more than 40% of illiteracy is there in the case of this country? It's all because, not having an inclusive growth, as she rightly pointed out. Inclusive means including the excluded sections, excluded sectors, that is SCs, STs, minorities, and also the rural-based sectors. Sectors, sections, all these are bypassed by the process of development. Therefore, now we are talking about inclusive growth. And inclusive growth is a sort of a moderate word, which is supposed to be taken because the overall perspective of the 11th plan itself is inclusive growth. And we aim at 9% of the average rate of growth during the 11th plan. But if you look at before the presentation of budget, always there will be an economic survey that is being done every year. And then budget will have three important aspects, I think all of you may be knowing. Number one is that it will have the actual expenditure and income for the past year, and then the actual expenditure and income of the last year in the sense one year before this year, and then actual of this income and expenditure of this year, and estimated expenditure and revenues for the coming year. So for this year, actually we are supposed to present the budget in the month of February, but because of elections, they had only this vote on account budget and then followed by a proper budget very recently. Why in the month of June means it's because of elections. We had a full-fledged budget only recently, that is on 6th July. So whatever may be the budget, but the thing is, somebody was telling that budget is a short-term measure, that is only income and expenditure for one particular year. But these short-term measures are part of the overall long-term measures, or overall strategy, or overall philosophy and overall policy of the government over a period of time. So even if it is a short-term allocation of resources, but it should become part and parcel of the long-term policy and long-term strategy of any government in order to have some stable rate of growth. If you look at the rate of growth scenario in the case of our country over the past few years, in the early 30 years, that is between 1950s to 1980s, the average rate of growth was 3.5%. From 1980s onwards, the rate of growth picked up. That is between 1980 and 1990, the average rate of growth of Indian economy was 5%. It increased to 5%, that is during 1980s to 1990s. After 1990s, if you look at the average rate of growth, it is 6%. And after 2000, if you look at the rate of growth, you see it is 7% and more than 7% in the first decade of this particular period. In some years it has reached 9%, and therefore we have kept this 9% as the average rate of growth in the case of 11th plan period. So here one funny and important part of this analysis that we have to understand is, when you are talking about inclusive growth and rural development, etc., in the case of our country, is that why we have gone for this shift in the policy, economic policy. Which also reflects the budgetary policy of the government of India. After 1980s, say when India was facing a balance of payments crisis, so between 1950 to 1980, our philosophy was, we had socialistic policies introduced in this country. Some girl student was asking that why tax rates change, and despite changing the tax, why some people are not paying the taxes. So when we were children, I was going to high school, we used to discuss among ourselves, if there is 96% of highest tax rate in the country, who pays 96%? We used to say the cinema actors will pay 96% or 97%. N.T. Ramara will pay 96%, Jamuna will pay 96%, because the only actors whom we know, because we are from rural areas, Jamuna and also N.T. Ramara, at that time we are very important actors. Because they were highly paid during their particular time, and therefore we used to take them as examples. And these tax rates, which are a part of budget, they reflected the overall strategy of the government. That is, we had socialistic pattern of society, achievement of socialistic pattern of society in our mind. Therefore, we could see that inequalities are to be curbed, and that's why the highest tax was the policy of the government. Then we had land reforms introduced in the country. Then we had, MRTs Act, that is the Monopolies and Restricted Practice, Trade Practice Act in the case of industrial sector. Both in industry and agriculture sector, and overall policy was reflecting the socialistic policies of the government in the case of the first two decades at least. But from 1980s onwards, the seeds of liberalization was sown during the period of Rajiv Gandhi. the seeds of liberalization. As soon as he became the Prime Minister of the country, he's a young man, and he was seeing what changes are taking place, especially in the case of neighboring Asian countries, so-called Asian giants. When the rate of growth of all these Asian giants was picking up, India was going at a very low pace of only 3.5%. We used to keep the card minimum 5%, sometimes 6%, but our average rate of growth was only 3.5% in the first three decades. Then the champions of liberalization policies, they said that unless we change the policy of economy, the economic policy, it is not possible to have a higher rate of growth. In the beginning, what we thought was, social perspective is more important than achieving higher rate of growth. But later, we realized when our Asian giants, when they went on achieving 7%, 8%, 9%, and Chinese economy was growing at the rate of 11 to 12% during that particular period. And China is a neighboring country. There are a lot of similarities between China and India except ideology. That is, they have got a communist model of development and we have got mixed economy model of development in the case of our country. So at that time, then the champions of liberalization policy, they advocated that because India followed a state policy, that is a statism. Statism means giving more importance to state and government intervening at all levels and public sector intervening at all levels and then private sector playing the role of only a small brother to the big brother, that is public sector, and then only we will be achieving the social objectives. That was the philosophy in the first 30 years. When rate of growth was less and that philosophy failed, therefore the champions of liberalization policies, they said, if you liberalize the policies, we will achieve higher rate of growth. And from 1980s, seeds of liberalization we have sown, and there is the picking up of rate of growth in the case of the economy. Then the champions of liberalization policy, they said, you see how the rate of growth is picking up. It has picked up to 5%, and all the while we are achieving only 3.5%, and therefore liberalize further. Then 1990s onwards, the present Prime Minister, who was the finance minister in the case of P.V. Narasimha's cabinet, then it was called Manmohanomics at the time. That is, from 1990, there was a crisis in the case of balance of payments. And in India, we have lost credibility all over the world. And there were change of prime ministers in the country. For 13 days, one prime minister, 6 months, another prime minister, 3 months, another prime minister. Several prime ministers changed in a period of 5 years. So only from 1990s onwards, after P.V. Narasimha became the Prime Minister and Manmohan Singh became the Finance Minister, for 5 years, I think, continuously there was a government from 1990s onwards. At the time, they said that when the scenario around us is changing, we have to also think of changing our policy in the case of our country. And we have to see that how we can link India with the overall, world economy. So therefore, integration of Indian economy to world economy started more in an accelerating speed from 1990s onwards, when we have gone for globalization, liberalization, private policies in the case of this country. So here, why I'm trying to put all of you in the case of this perspective is, we have to understand the budget and analyze the budget from the angle of overall economic policy. When you have gone for liberalization and globalization policies, the definitely budget reflects only the overall globalization, liberalization policies. In this process, definitely, the process of rural development will be suffering and it will be bypassed. For the past 60 years, why most of the people in this country, or 80% of the people in this country, are bypassed, and why they are still remaining only in the rural areas, and why the scenario has changed in the case of Western countries like America and other countries is, it is because our policy is different and our performance is totally different. So you can take up any scheme or any type of policy that is being implemented in this country. Policies by themselves are very good, but we are failure in the process of implementation. That's why the impact of the policies is, although it is intended to target certain sections and certain sectors in this country, but unfortunately they are being bypassed. Whether it is rural sector oriented policy, or whether it is a certain target group oriented policy. So ultimately, the benefits of all these policies are wiped out by the middle people. So all the policies which are aimed at rural development in this country, they bypass the rural people. They bypass the poor people in this country. Otherwise, we have introduced Panchayat Raj system in this country. We had excellent programs implemented as a part of Panchayat Raj, which is aimed at development of rural areas, all-round development of rural areas, because we had a community development program which is introduced in this country, because all public administration people know that the philosophy of community development was development of the community, by the community, and for the community. That is rural community. So overall, our so-called integrated rural development you are talking about, it was the philosophy of community development during that particular period. but we have failed to implement. So therefore, from 1980s onwards, again we are talking about integrative development. And we are saying that in our budgets, all these rural development objectives are to be reflected, that we are talking about. Even if you look at this recent budget is not exception to the past year budgets. Although government, you know, people have been talking about that it is a different budget from, I mean, other budgets, it is not exceptional budget because, as rightly pointed out by Professor Haragopal, it is also part and parcel of liberalization policies. And it is also aimed at addressing the so-called global meltdown or recession that is taking place outside the world. And it's because if you look at the tax structure, if you look at the direct taxes, indirect tax structure in the case of the budget, you know, there is no fundamental change in the tax structure if you look at the overall budget, whether direct tax or indirect taxes. I am not going to analyze all those things because the time is very short, but I will come down to my own topic, that is especially the rural perspective of this particular budget. So if you see the Hindu paper, which is on the next day, that is after 6th, that is 7th Hindu newspaper, the broad outline, why I am trying to talk about only Hindu newspaper is because that newspaper is supposed to be non-controversial and it is supposed to be more objective. That paper is itself, the main title of the paper itself is, this is the budget which is aimed to spur the rate of growth via spending more on rural areas. That is how the, because I mean, although the rate of growth that is aimed at in the case of 11th plan is an average rate of growth of 9%, but during the past 1 year, if you see the performance of the the performance of our economy is very, very poor. I think it is below the 7%. I think 6.7 or 6.5% rate of growth we could achieve. And earlier years, 7%, 7.5%, 8% rate of growth also we could achieve. But during the past, you know, few years, if you look at the rate of growth, it is an average 8.5% during the past 4 years. And during the last year, the performance is very bad. It is below 7%. Rightly pointed out again in the Professor Haragopal's speech, they would like to spend more on rural masses because they want to create more demand in order to address the resources and problems so as to achieve higher rate of growth in the case of our economy. So that is how, you know, we have to look at the budget. But if you see the allocations also, in the morning, Professor Ram Brahman gar also, in his my point of view and Professor Ram Brahman, presentation in the morning, it coincides because lot of schemes which he talked about, they are part and parcel of the rural development schemes only. One of the most important, issue related to the rural development, rural masses is this so-called National Rural Employment Guarantee Scheme. And how you are going to have a bias towards this rural development process in the case of the present budget is by spending more on this so-called NRGS, that is National Rural Employment Guarantee Scheme, which is supposed to address to the unemployment problem in rural areas. Because you know, that we are talking now about right to education, but we never talked about right to employment. But you know, if all of us think seriously, right to food, education, they are not so important as right to employment. Because if right to employment is guaranteed, all other rights will be guaranteed. Your right to education is guaranteed, right to food is guaranteed, everything is guaranteed if you are guaranteed right to employment. So all the while, right from beginning, we are not talking about this. If you provide employment, you get income, and automatically you will have food, you will have clothing, you will have shelter. Why should we have so many schemes of shelter, food, clothing, etc.? Why not we talk about one particular scheme, that is how to generate employment to all illiterate and literate masses in this country so that enough income is generated and they will survive on that. All basic necessities like housing we are talking about, and then clothing, and then food. No need for Food Security Act if you provide employment to all the people in this country. So therefore, we have totally failed in this country in providing employment, especially to the rural masses. Because, you know, educated people are also, of course, not totally covered by the employment policy, but to a great extent, you know, they have been the beneficiaries. But as far as illiterate masses are concerned, we have failed to address to the issue of, unemployment in the case of rural areas. And that's why they don't have sufficient income. And therefore, they are not in a position to generate sufficient demand for the goods that are produced in the case of rural economy. And that's why 30% of the population still in the rural areas is below the poverty line. And in this particular budget, the major focus is on creation of employment through the so-called National Rural Employment Guarantee Scheme. It's one of the rural employment generation program which is given more priority in the case of this present budget. But it is only a mere palliative. That is, it's only a solution to the temporary problem, but it cannot address totally the problem of unemployment in the case of rural areas. They say that we are hiking the expenditure by 144% over the last year. And we would like to cover more households in the case of rural areas as a part of employment guarantee program. That is what they are talking about. And then they are also saying, as rightly pointed out by Professor Ram Brahman in the morning, that is, they would like to ensure minimum 100 rupees per day as a part of that employment guarantee scheme in the case of rural areas. It's one of the wonderful programs, I can say. That is, in the short term, in order to address the problem of unemployment and also address the problem of poverty, they are trying to allocate more to the rural people in the way of, I mean, this hiking expenditure on employment generation in the case of rural areas. But I think Andhra Pradesh is the only state, because every day there is some report in the press about the functioning of this National Rural Guarantee Employment Program. Ours is the only state in the country which is to some extent successful in implementation of this particular program. All other, most of the states, this program is not functioning well. I am not trying to appreciate our own state too much, but when compared to other states, we are better. Because there is one important measure taken up by the Andhra Pradesh government, that is, social auditing is there on this National Rural Employment Guarantee Program in Andhra Pradesh state. Social auditing means the other people, that is, implementers are somebody, and then auditing of this particular program is done by somebody else. So whether this particular program is properly implemented or not, there is a social auditing that is going on in the case of villages. Therefore, their loopholes are less in implementation in Andhra Pradesh when compared to other states. But other states, funds are coming, people are knocking away the funds, they are eating, that is, the middlemen are eating the funds that are allocated towards the National Rural Employment Guarantee Program in the case of other states. This is the experience of most of the states like Orissa and other states. There are also field experience which shows that, you know, there is a lot of pilferage as a part of these programs in the case of those states. So some impact will be there on rural masses in wiping out rural poverty because of this particular program, and unemployment problems to some extent you can address, but not totally, provided if implementation of this program takes place properly, even if you hike the expenditure on this program by 144%. So we have to welcome this 144% hike in the expenditure, but at the same time, we are also having a doubt that whether it can be implemented, like at least in Andhra Pradesh, as it is implemented in the case of other states. There are more than 20 states in this country. So what is the, credibility of other states, and whether these states are sincere in implementation is a very big question mark. This is one thing. And second thing is, there are also certain other measures that are being taken up as a part of rural development strategy in the case of the present budget, like Bharat Nirman. Bharat Nirman is nothing but building of rural infrastructure. It's also a major rural development activity that is being taken up. They wanted to allocate the 45% hike in the expenditure is there as a part of this particular Bharat Nirman program. It's an excellent, activity that is being taken up. But what we are seeing is that a lot of pilferage of funds is taking place in this. Unfortunately, in this country, the government is spending, a lot of budget is being created, allocations are being made, but what is happening to these allocations? For the past 60 years, if you look at the allocations, then most of these allocations or benefits of these allocations are going to the pockets of middlemen. If that was not the case, the rural poverty would not have been there in this country. Unemployment problem would not be there in this country. Isn't it? And as pointed out by Haragopal, only 20 industrial houses would not have amassed a lot of capital in their hands. There is a lot of Tatas, Bilas, etc. When we are talking about, socialist pattern of society and, restriction of, monopolies and trade, implementation of monopolies and restrictive trade practices act, and then deconcentration of economic power in the hands of few people, all those legislations are there. But in actual practice, the gap between rich and poor has been growing. Not only the gap between rich and poor, but the gap between rural and also urban areas has been growing over a period of time. And therefore, 80% of the population is still living in the rural areas. And as pointed out by some of the speakers in the morning, that the person is unable to get a cycle, but another fellow is running, not Maruti car. Cycle fellow has switched out Maruti car. From Maruti car, he's going to an AC car. And again, the AC car, so he's trying to choose whether I should go for Icon, or I should go for, Tavera, or I should go for, Khalis, what type of vehicle, or Scorpio. They are thinking too much about these things, isn't it? So that's why we have to try to understand. The development is taking place. And if you see the Hyderabad roads sometimes in the evening, very difficult for you and minimum 1 hour it takes. Suppose if you want to go from Manu to Supal, I think more than 1 hour is required, because that is a traffic problem. This shows that if you look at all these cars, you think that India is not a poor country, isn't it? But if you go to rural area, that fellow is still living in a hut. He has no proper lighting, he has no proper clothing, no proper, food, and no proper, shelter. All these things are there, no proper roads in the case of villages. This is the scenario if you look at. So this is a dualism that is there in the development process in this country. So therefore, what we have to say is, even if budget allocations are there to the rural development, but these allocations are wiped away by the middlemen who belong to the urban areas. It is urban people who are trying to swallow the funds that are supposed to be flowed to the rural areas. This is the most important factor which you have to understand. Therefore, in infrastructure also, although the government hiked the funds by 45%, but I am sure that we have got a lot of doubts again, as we have got doubt about NRGS, whether these funds will really enter into the construction of infrastructure in the case of rural areas, again a big question mark. Then another most important thing is a national housing bank. They would like to with the 200 crores they would like to provide for national housing bank. So this is supposed to address the housing problem in the case of rural areas. But now already some Indira, housing program is going on, and so much of hue and cry and so much of criticism is there on housing program as a part of Indira Avas Yojana itself. So for the past several years, you have been hearing that this minister goes, that minister goes, and they give the pattas and they also hand over the houses. But these houses, you find a lot of malpractices and corruption taking place in the case of the housing program also. So that's why pilferages are bound to be there in this program, although it's a good program that is being talked about. And then another most important, very unique program, which is discussed by Professor Ram Brahmam as a part of this rural development, is Prime Minister's Grameen Adarsh Yojana. It is a unique program that is announced as a part of this budget, aiming at the rural masses, aiming at the development of integrated development of villages. And there are some 1,000 crore rupees is allocated in this budget only for the development of 100,000 villages which are having more than 50% SC/ST population in the case of rural areas. So they have identified about 1,000 villages initially where these villages are having more than 50% SC/ST population, and they want integrated development of these villages with these 1,000 crores. But it should become part and parcel of the long-term policy of the government. So if you allocate 1,000 crore this year, next year you have to think in terms of continuously allocating more and more funds. In that way, I think there can be development of at least these villages which are located in remote places and also having more and more weaker sections like SC/STs in the case of the country. So this is another wonderful program that is being announced apart from this Swarna Jayanti Swarojgar Yojana. This is already a program which is meant for development of women in the case of rural areas, and this time they have allocated again more funds for this particular program in order to see that more than 50% of rural women are enrolled as a part of this particular program. Out of the total rural women, they would like to enroll nearly 50% of rural women during this particular year itself as a part of self-help groups, wherein they can think in terms of becoming self-sufficient, self-reliant, and income generating. But you know what is the fate of self-help groups also. What is happening to the self-help? In some places, of course, I think Professor Ram Brahmam will agree with me that although the program, that is a self-help groups program, that is a so-called SSGs program, which now and then we see CM going and ministers going and MLAs going immediately, showing even to the foreigners what is happening, how the self-help groups are working in the case of rural areas in this country. The most important point is that the political consciousness of rural women has gone up. This is what I can say. But as an economist, I don't agree with the idea that there is a lot of change in the livelihoods of rural women because of SSGs. There is enrollment, groups have come up, and they have been also getting the funds from the bank, and they have been also, they also show on the record that they are, working on some activity, and there is also generation of funds, but they have become only vote banks to the government. All these self-help groups, if you catch hold of one leader of a self-help group, all the persons who are members of that, they will be, voting for that particular political party. If you give bribe the leader of that particular party, all the Yeah, members of that particular group, they'll be ready to vote for the political party. So more they are working in order to bring political consciousness and all the vote banks rather than bringing about a change in the livelihoods of the people in this country. It's an excellent scheme, and the government would like to, further improve the allegations on this scheme. But the thing is that the scheme should really work for upliftment of rural women in the case of this country, because rural women constitute 50% of the human resource in this country. And they are also bypassed by the development process, not only rural masses, but apart from that, the rural women are the most important and negligent resources which are bypassed by the process of development. So therefore, schemes as such that are given importance as a part of the budget, they are good, and we find more allocations in the case of the present budget. And if you look at the total budget scenario, in the entire budget, nearly 62% of the total budget allocations are supposed to go to the rural development schemes. 62%. It means nearly two-thirds. Two-thirds means 66% of the allocations. 62% of the total allocations supposed to go to the rural schemes. If really 62% go, there can be some change in the case of rural scenario. But we very much doubt, again, all of us should think very carefully whether all this 62% of the total budget goes to the upliftment of rural poor, including rural women. Is that again a big question mark before all of us? And that's why my overall, comment on this budget and its relation with rural development is that rural development is an objective that we have kept right from beginning of the plan in this country. Right from first plan up to the 11th plan, we are talking about giving importance to rural development. But in the process of implementation of several schemes aimed at rural development and also rural women in this country, they have bypassed all these people, and then allocations that are being made, they are being pilfered, and they have gone into the pockets of the middlemen in the case of rural areas. That's why how to curb these malpractices in the process of implementation of the schemes is a very important question mark before the policymakers. And unless we curb these malpractices, I think it is not possible, whatever the scheme that you announce, it is not possible to reach and also to uplift the livelihood of the rural masses in this country. So with these few observations, once again, I thank my very good friend, that is Professor Iqbal Ahmad, the acting vice chancellor of this university, and Professor Rahmatullah, and all the teaching staff, non-teaching staff, and all the student friends here for giving us an opportunity to come and express our views. Thank you very much once again.